In this video, I want to show you how I water my garden using an ESP8266 microcontroller and relay cards. You may have seen the teaser video where I actually push a button on my mobile phone and the sprinkler goes off. Pushing the button again switches it off. So what do we need to build this? We need any ESP8266 microcontroller. The most popular at the moment is the Wemos D1 Mini, which is shown here. It has an ESP8266 and also a USB interface, which makes it very easy to use, especially for beginners. A larger version exists, the Wemos D1, which has the same format like the Arduino Uno and is to a large extent pin compatible to the Arduino Uno. Alternatively, you can put everything on a breadboard. Unfortunately, the ESP8266 as such is not very breadboard friendly, but you can use a breadboard adapter, they cost roughly a dollar or two. In order to control the water flow, we need a valve. For safety reasons, we use a valve that is normally closed, that means no water will flow unless it is powered. These valves are available in different diameters and voltages. The ESP microcontroller does not have an output that is powerful enough to drive the valve directly, so we will use a relay to power the valve. A relay is an electric switch that can be triggered by a quite low current, but can then switch devices with quite high power on and off. The modules that are made for the Arduino are mostly compatible and really not expensive. Last but not least, we need the right software. Theo Arendt from the Netherlands has written a great firmware called Tasmota, so let's Google for this and then download it from his GitHub. Tasmota is available in many languages, also in some weird languages like German, for example. Let's just use the default version here, which is tasmota.bin, and save it on our PC. Before we start assembling the pieces, let's see what the desired result in our lab environment should look like. I have a browser open on my mobile phone, and pushing the toggle button would then switch the valve on and off. Hey guys, this is 1Mark50. My name is Mark. I hope you're all well. When I did this video, I wanted to show how things with this valve actually work. Because when it's just lying on the table, one could say, well, Mark can tell us everything, we don't know if it works or not. So I built this little model, and the idea was also to add a little bit of drama to the video, right? In the sense that I wanted to put some colored liquid in here, and a second recipient here, and when I push the button, slosh, the liquid will go into the second recipient. It kind of worked, except for the drama bit. Watch for yourself.
So this is the model with the valve still closed. You can see the blue water in the right recipient, the valve in the middle, and the second recipient on the left. Now watch what happens when I push the button. Okay, I told you, there will be no drama, right? No, seriously. If you are a science teacher in chemistry or physics, and you spent the whole afternoon preparing an experiment which you wanted to show in class the next day, and then it just didn't work, I know exactly how you feel. The reason it didn't work is because the valve needs a certain water pressure to open. During normal operations, the valve will sit directly on the water tap and hence there will be a big pressure that can push it open. The small amount of water I had in the model was just not enough to push it open completely. Next, let's see what we need in order to flash the software onto the microcontroller. From a wiring perspective, all you have to do with the Wemos D1 Mini or the D1 is plug it into the USB port of your PC, that's all. With the ESP on a breadboard, we need to do some more wiring. We need a reset button and a programming button on GPIO0. In order to launch the microcontroller in flashing or programming mode, these buttons need to be pressed in a certain sequence. First, we press and hold the GPIO0 button. We then press and release the reset button. The microcontroller now starts in programming mode and we can release the GPIO0 button. Next thing we need is a software to flash the binary onto the microcontroller. The best command line tool I know of is a Python script called esptool. But I know that most people do not want to use command line tools, so I searched for a graphical tool. If you Google for NodeMCU PyFlasher, you will find Marcel Stör's GitHub, where you can download the executable for Mac or Windows. You can copy it to your desktop and launch it directly. No installation is needed, as the executable contains all necessary runtime elements. Thanks a lot, Marcel, for that. So let's do exactly that, and as you can see, we can either specify the serial port where our ESP is connected to, or we can leave it to automatic. The baud rate you can select depends on the hardware you're using, but 115,200 should work in most cases. Browse for the Tasmota bin file, which we have downloaded before. I want to be safe and tell it to erase all data that might still be in the flash memory. And once I click on Flash NodeMCU, PyFlasher will launch the ESP-tool Python script and flash the microcontroller. In reality, this will take much longer. I have accelerated that part in the video. Now next, we need to configure the Tasmota firmware. I'm just launching the Arduino IDE because I want to read what Tasmota wants to tell me over the serial interface. You do not have to do this, but it is a useful step to get insights into what is going on. Here we can see that the microcontroller has booted. Please note the baud rate of 74,880 baud. This is the default baud rate for the ESP microcontroller at boot time. Below we can see some gibberish, and that is because Tasmota uses a different baud rate. So if I switch this to 115,200, I can see what Tasmota is trying to tell me. It says the web server is active and that it has an IP address of 192.168.4.1. So how do I connect to this web interface? In fact, the ESP has become a Wi-Fi access point. So what I need to do is scan for the Tasmota underscore something Wi-Fi and connect to it. Next, I can then connect to the 192.168.4.1 IP address and the Tasmota config page opens. This is where I can tell it which Wi-Fi it should connect to in normal times. So just type in the SSID of my IoT network and the Wi-Fi password, and Tasmota stores this and will connect to this access point the next time it boots. I still have my serial monitor open so I can sneak peek and check if things worked as expected. And yes, it tells me it has connected to my IoT Wi-Fi, and it also tells me its new IP address, 172.16.0.134. Okay, let me change the Wi-Fi connection to my normal LAN and browse to that IP address where I expect the Tasmota web server to be. Here it is. So now I can complete the configuration. First, I tell it which hardware it is running on. Tasmota supports a lot of different Sonoff hardware, but in my case, we are not on a Sonoff device, but rather on a generic device. Next, I need to configure the pins where I will later connect the relay to. In my case, I will use GPIO 12 for the relay, and as I have a button already on GPIO 0, I might also tell Tasmota about it. If you want to integrate this into your home automation system, you can do so by using the MQTT protocol. Tasmota has integrated MQTT capabilities. All you need to do is specify the server IP or name and possibly a username and password. Tasmota has now rebooted and I can switch the relay on and off using the toggle button. So let's wire the relay and the valve. If you are using a D1 or D1 mini, you can just connect the relay card to the Wemos device using jumper wires. On the breadboard, we will do the same thing just by wiring GPIO 12 to the relay module input. Keep in mind that the relay itself needs to be powered with 5 volts as it is made for the Arduino, while the ESP itself uses 3.3 volts. The switching part of the relay then needs to connect the valve to 12 volts as shown in the diagram. Here we go, everything is wired as described and pushing the toggle button on the browser opens and closes the valve. When I built this, I noticed strange things going on, such as the green LED I'm using to indicate the state of the valve was suddenly destroyed, or the memory of my microcontroller was erased. The reason for this is that the valve actually contains a coil. Powering the coil builds up a magnetic field that is destroyed when the valve is closed again. Unfortunately, when the magnetic field breaks down, it induces a negative charge. When I hook up the valve to the same power supply like the ESP, this can, in the worst case, destroy my microcontroller. Let me actually show you this on the oscilloscope. I have connected the oscilloscope directly to the 12 volts on the valve. Now I switch it on, and the voltage goes up to 12 volts. However, if I switch it off, you will notice a negative peak that can reach many, many volts. Here we are. Let me show you this in detail once more. Switching it on, 12 volts. Switching it off, negative peak. We need to take countermeasures against this to prevent our project from being destroyed. Luckily, all we need is a diode that we connect to the valve in blocking direction. That is, the diode is connected the, so to speak, wrong way because we do not want it to short circuit the valve during normal operations, only the negative induced voltage. Let's check this on the oscilloscope once more. Here we go. Switching it on, 12 volts just like before. Now, switching it off, no more peak, just a little ripple voltage of minus 0.7 volt, that should be okay. Perfect! All we need to do now is connect the valve to the water tap. Make sure that the valve is the first thing you connect to the tap and that everything else like hoses follows after. As we are leaving the water tap open all the time, we do not want our basement or garage flooded by an exploded hose. This concludes today's episode. Many thanks for watching. I hope you liked the video. Stay safe, stay healthy. Bye for now. We'll be right back.